Welcome back, children, to your online English classes. We are going to start with Landscape of the Soul today by Natalie Troveroy from your book Hornbill. So, children, before we start, let me just ask you a question. Why should you read the story? What is the need for reading the story? Any idea, any guesses? Why should I need to cover the story or read the story? Children, it is very well connected to our daily life also. And basically, I would like to say all of us are interested in art, isn't it? All of us love art, whether it is in the basic form, whether it is in the raw form, or it is drawn by a famous painter. We all love art. So here, Natalie Troveroy classifies art, you know, into many types of art, like Chinese art, European art, and brute art. Children, knowing something in depth helps us to appreciate that particular knowledge. Do not actually have a kind of superficial knowledge. Whenever you are really in love with something, all of us love art, isn't it? So it is better to have some in-depth knowledge also. So here we are going to read about Chinese art, European art, and brute art. I am not asking you to go in for an art class. It will be done with detailed explanation in the form of a story right now. So what is Chinese art, children? I have highlighted this introductory paragraph because I want you to understand this Chinese art before we move on. CP, I have marked it as CP because I wanted it to be clear in front of you. CP stands for Chinese painting. A wonderful old tale is told about the painter Yu Daozi, who lived in the 8th century. His last painting was a landscape commissioned by the Tang Emperor Zhuangzong to decorate a palace wall. Now the artist had hidden his work behind a screen so only the emperor would see it, nobody else. For a long while, the emperor admired the wonderful scene, discovering forests, high mountains, waterfalls, clouds floating in an immense blue sky, men on the hilly paths, flights of birds. So see, the beautiful picture was being admired and appreciated. The beautiful painting was being admired and appreciated. But when the painter wanted the emperor to enter his art, see, the painter clapped his hands and the entrance to the cave opened. The inside is splendid, Your Majesty, beyond anything words can convey. Please let me show Your Majesty the way. The painter entered the cave, but the entrance closed behind him and everything vanished before the emperor could move or speak a word. So these kind of stories played an important part in China's classical education. The books of Confucius and Zhuangzi are full of them. Why? Because they help the master to guide his disciple in the right direction. So, the master helps the disciple in this way, that you go deep inside your knowledge, inside yourself. Do not be superficial. Go deep inside yourself and find out the spirit that is there inside you. Okay, the spiritual or the conceptual place inside you, the inner spirit of life that is inside you. These are all the concepts of Chinese painting, that is discovering the inner spirit of life, revealing the spirit of life in which the art was considered. Okay, also bringing out an inner and spiritual world in the art. There is another famous story about a painter who wouldn't draw the dragon's eye because he feared that it would fly out of the painting. Means the art was such a kind of depiction of inner life and spirit that even the painter hesitated to make the art so realistic, and it was some kind of realization for everyone that it is the essence, that life, the inner spirit was the or is the, it is still now the essence of Chinese art, right? But what is Western art or Western painting, children? This is in deep contrast. Western art or Western painting is in deep contrast with Chinese painting. In 15th century, art work, a master blacksmith called Quentin Metzis fell in love with a painter's daughter. And obviously, the painter will not accept a blacksmith to marry his daughter. And so, what did Quentin do? Quentin painted a fly on his latest drawing. He painted a fly with such delicate realism, with such devotion, with such delicate realistic art it was, that the master or the girl's father wanted to fly that fly before he realized that it was a drawing. So these two stories illustrate what each form of art, the Western painting and the Chinese painting, is trying to achieve: a perfect illusionistic likeness in Western painting and the essence of inner life and spirit in Chinese painting. Again, we come to Chinese painting. Let me show you the way, because here every time the path is unknown to the person who is seeing the art, the person who is appreciating the art. The path is unknown, excepting the artist himself. So, in this Chinese story, the emperor commissions, in the Chinese story that we had read in the beginning of this lesson, the emperor orders, that art to be drawn, the landscape painting, and appreciates the mountains, the hills, and the rivers. That is already there in the introduction paragraph. The emperor appreciates. But the artist reveals to him the true meaning of his work. But the artist, what does he try to do? It is not only on top. The appreciation is there. The appreciation is there inside the art. And so, this kind of material appearance is far, far is there in the Western painting, whereas something beyond material appearance is there in the Chinese painting. A classical Chinese landscape is not meant to produce an actual view. It is not going to paint an actual view as would a Western figurative painting. So, Western figurative painting will always give you the actual view that you can make out easily, like the fly. But a Chinese landscape wants you to introspect, go deep inside it. His landscape is not a real one, and you can enter it from any point, then travel it. The artist creates a path for your eyes to travel up and down, back and forth, in a leisurely, in a casual way. You can relax, you can enjoy the Chinese art in a very, very liberal way, in a leisured way, in a relaxed way, right? So the landscape is an inner one. The landscape of the soul is an inner one. It is a depiction of your soul. It is a depiction of your spiritual and inner conceptual space, means inner, the space that is there within you, because the artist wants you to enter his mind. Okay. We are moving on to Taoism. This concept is known as Shansui. Shansui here represents the two elements. One is the mountain Yang reaching vertically towards heaven. The second is the water Yin, horizontal and resting on the earth. One is the mountain Yang, vertical. The second is Yin, horizontal, fluid, moist, cool. And then the interaction of Yin and its counterpart Yang. Okay, these two energies, Yin and Yang, when they interact with each other is Taoism. And where their interaction takes place, it is known as middle void. Middle void, that empty space that can be compared with the yogic practice of pranayama. Pranayama, breathe in, breathe out. The suspension, where you pause. When you breathe in, you pause, breathe out. That is what is pranayama, isn't it? That particular section of pause is containing that interaction of Yin and Yang, the feminine and the masculine. They interact, and this is that fundamental notion of Taoism. Where does the interaction take place? In the middle void, where it can be understood with the help of, which can be very well understood with the help of yogic practice of pranayama. Breathing in, pause, breathe out. In that section of pause, that interaction Yin and Yang, interaction of Yin and Yang takes place. Hence, the importance of the white, unpainted space in Chinese landscape. And we move on to brute art now. What is the brute art? Brute art is a new form of art. It can be called the art of an untrained visionary artist with no formal training. Yet, they show talent and artistic vision. They have got too much of talent and artistic vision. They have got innovativeness. They have got unique vision. They are creative and they are very, very good also, expert also in bringing out their vision and creation. But they can be called as what? They can be called as there. I'm coming down to show you. See here, the notion of brute art or raw art. They can be called as self-artist, self-taught artist. Like Nick Chan. Nick Chan is known as self-taught artist. He was the creator of Rock Garden. Right? He is the creator of Rock Garden. And recognizing his art as an outstanding testimony of the difference a single man can make when he lives his dream. He lived his dream and he made that beautiful rock garden in Chandigarh. It's a kind of perfect example of this kind of art. So what is brute art? Brute art is known as a raw art or unprofessional art by a self-taught artist. But it does not mean it is without creativity. It is extremely creative, extremely innovative, extremely unique. But it doesn't have any kind of professionalism. They have received no formal training. Right? So that is how we end the chapter. We have got